you're here today. If you're here this morning and you're not ready to meet the Lord, this message is for you. You don't understand what all this is about, what church is about, what being a Christian is about. This is for you. As a preacher, you can't preach a greater message than you must be born again. And that's what I'd like to preach to you about this morning. This is one of those days, I believe, that will go down in history, marked on the calendar, as a day that somebody, the greatest thing in life, happened to somebody. I realize and know that I'm nothing this morning. I don't claim to be anything. If you're here this morning, you say, well, all right, let's see what kind of person he is. You missed it the whole way. I never have claimed to be nothing. But I can tell you about somebody that can help you this morning. I'm going to tell you about somebody that can help you. There's people here, all over this building here this morning, that your life is absolutely in a mess. I mean, you don't know which way to turn. It's all messed up, and it's like you're going down in a spiral, and you're going to hit one of these days, and that's called death. Here in John chapter 3, we find the answer to what you need. Verse 1, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. Now, I want you to stop there just a second. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. It may be religious flesh, but it's still flesh. It may be righteous or, in the world's eyes, rule-keeping, law-abiding flesh. It's still flesh. It may be handsome flesh or beautiful flesh or attractive flesh or rich flesh, but it's flesh. And it's no good. And that which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. Marvel that I said unto thee, you must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of Spirit. There's 3 points I'd like to make this morning, and if you'd give me attention and listen to them very carefully. Bible said, this man came to Jesus Christ named Nicodemus. And the Bible said he came to him by night. That's not an accident. The Holy Spirit put that in the Bible. Everybody who comes to Jesus comes to him by night in darkness. When I came to the Lord, I was in darkness. When I got saved, the night I got saved at Nebo Baptist Church, I was in darkness. The Bible said about this man, got me on, it's on the red one. About this man, the Bible said his name was Nicodemus, and he was a ruler of the Jews. He was a man of the Pharisees. So the first thing I want to say this morning is that Jesus was talking to a religious man. Jesus was talking to a religious man. God is not impressed with how religious we are. Did you know that just everybody in the world is religious? Everybody has religion. Somebody said, well, so-and-so's got a lot of religion, but I'm not religious. That's not true. Everybody's got a religion. They worship something or somebody, and if they don't worship somebody, they worship their self or the car or the money or drugs or alcohol or the flesh or something. Everybody has a God. Everybody has a God. Jesus was talking to a religious person. Man by nature is religious. We have something that catches our affections and we idolize that thing, and that is the meaning of the word worship. Man is naturally religious. You say, well, Brother Danny, won't religion take you to heaven? No, religion will not take you to heaven. Everybody is religious. There's people in countries of this world who worship rocks and trees and dogs and flowers. In India this morning, they worship rats. They believe that rats are sacred. Cows are sacred. But that will not take a person to heaven. Religion will do nothing for you except make you more miserable. Let me explain it like this. Religion is something that man does for God. To try to please God. To try to satisfy God. To try to earn God's favor. Religion is do's and don'ts. Religion is do this. Do this, do this, do this, don't do this, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. That's what religion is. And there is some good religion in the Bible. The Bible talks of pure religion. There is something good about religion. But religion by itself will never satisfy the demands of God. And religion by itself will never take you to heaven when you die. Let me tell you the difference. Everybody listen. This is one of the most important statements I'll make in the next few minutes. Listen to me. Religion is what you can do for God. Salvation, listen to me. Salvation is what God does you that you cannot do for yourself. I thank God this morning I found out that I got salvation, and it's something that God did for me that I could not do for myself. You know, if a man got religion, say when he's 20 years old, and let's say when you're 20 years old, you quote, get religion. Or you're 25, or you're 30. You know what? If you could, and you can't, but if you could, I start at 25 years old and live perfect the rest of your life and never sin one time from the time you was 25 to the time you died, you still could not go to heaven because you've got 5 years worth of sins that have not been paid for. Religion is what you can do for God. Salvation is when you call on God as a sinner and you realize that He has to do something for you that you for yourself, and the Lord Jesus Christ comes in your heart, that is salvation. My question to you this morning, has that ever happened to you? Jesus looked at this man who was a very, very religious man. This man was a man of the Pharisee, of the most strict religious sect of that day. He kept all the rules. They wouldn't eat a bite of food without washing their hands. They kept the very strictest rule of the Old Testament commandments. They would only walk so far a Sabbath day. If they took one step further than a certain distance on the Sabbath day, they would be breaking the law. They had all these laws that they had to keep. And Nicodemus was a ruler of the Jews. He was a Pharisee. He was a religious man. By our standards this morning, he could put any one of us to shame. He lived by a strict set of rules, a strict diet, he would not eat certain things he would not touch. He said, this is part of my religion as a Jew, and I will not do this, and I will not eat that. But Jesus looked at that man and said, Nicodemus, it's not enough. You must be born again. You must be born again. If you want to go to heaven when you die, you must be born again. All right, everybody in here wants to go to heaven, right? I don't think anybody in here wants to go to hell. So everybody in here wants to go to heaven. If you want to go to heaven when you die, let me tell you what you got to do. I will not ask you to join this church. That won't do you good. I will not ask you to put money in the plate. That'll do you no good. You know what you've got to do? You've got to be born again. You've got to be born again. You understand that? You've got to be born again. I realize that a lot of music entertainers, athletes, and politicians have give the term born again a bad name, but it's still a Bible doctrine, still a Bible word, and you can't go to heaven unless you've been born again. You were born the first time as a little bitty baby.
And the problem is, the reason we have to be born again is we was born wrong to start with. You see what happened is years and years and years and years ago, your grandma and their 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 grandma goes all the way back to Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden. When Adam and Eve sinned, sin got in the human bloodstream, the human family. And it passed down to their kids, and 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 their kids, right on down to me and you. So when we was born with sinful blood running in our body. You, this morning, that's why it's so easy to do wrong and so hard to do right. I've had people say at funerals, I'm going to straighten up. And people say, out of the casket of a dead loved ones, I've got to straighten up. I've got to do better. Have you ever noticed how hard that is? It seems like you'll do better for a day or two, and you're right back doing the same old thing. You'll quote, straighten up for a little while, and then when the scare wears off, you go right back to the same old thing. You know why? It is your nature. It's born in you. You was born wrong the first time. You must be born again. I'm going to tell you how to do that this morning. Thank God I'm going to put the mail in your box this morning. And you've got the responsibility of opening it up and finding out what God sent you. So I can read it for you and I can't respond to you, but I'm going to put it in your box. And I'm telling you, he's talking to a religious man. Religion is man doing something for God. Salvation is God doing something for man. Have you ever noticed how easy it is to be wrong and how hard it is to be right? Have you ever noticed it's just like getting in a boat and floating down the river when everybody's going to a party or everybody's going to drink or everybody's going to live it up? It's easy. You know why? It comes natural to us. We're born that way. The Bible says the wicked go astray as soon as they be born speaking lies. You know, all the little babies we got in here in the nursery this morning, every one of them is born sinners. We're a sinner by nature. Then when we get old enough, become a sinner by choice. And then we become a sinner by habit. And if we're not born again and get a new nature put inside of us, there is no change in our life that will last or amount to a hill of beans. You know what I think this morning? You must be born again. You hear people all the time say, well, preacher, I can't come to church until I'm ready to live it. And they got good intentions when they say that, but the truth is you can't never live it. The truth is you can't never be good enough by yourself. God has to do something for you that you cannot do for yourself. Ever since I was 18 years old, I've been born again. I've been born again. I know that I've been born again. I know I was born the first time because I'm standing right here to prove it. All 145 pounds of me. And I know that I was born the second time because he came into my heart down on the altar that night, and there's been something on the inside that's never left me 1 second since then. I've been born again. So you know what I am now? I'm a good man living in a bad body. My flesh is still that old sinful flesh, but inside me lives the Spirit of God. And if you've been saved, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Your flesh still goes one way, but the Lord inside is pulling you the other way. When a man gets up and preaches, if you're saved, there's something in you that responds to it. Something in you saying, amen, that's right, that's the truth, I want to hear it. There's something inside you when you say you want to go, that begin to flutter, that begin to stir like a little whirlwind inside. Jesus said it's like a well of living water bubbling up in everlasting life. Thank God that you have a body that's been born again. Woo! I'm glad I've been born again. I'm glad I know exactly what he's talking about. You say, well, you don't look that much to me. That's because you can't see the good part. All you see is this house I live in. It ain't much. I'm in here looking at you through these two little windows right here. And I'm in here saying, hey, there's something good in here. And it's Jesus Christ. I've been born again. How about you? I would say that Jesus was talking to a religious man. I would say secondly this morning, and this will be very brief, he didn't mention baptism. Baptism is nowhere mentioned in this passage of Scripture. I know a lot of our friends like to argue that, and a lot of denominations teach that you have to be baptized in water, like you're in a baptistry, in order to be born again, because of Jesus' state of, you have to be born of water and of the Spirit. And the Camelot, or water dogs, as we respectfully call them, are people who teach that you must be baptized in order to go to heaven. The reason we say that is because it's an finished work of Jesus Christ to tack on anything to his finished work besides grace through faith and accepting his blood on the cross. I need $1,000 if you can find the word baptized in John 3. These people have a problem. Every time they see the word water, they think it means baptism. He didn't say anything about getting baptized. Read the context. The context of Nicodemus said, can a man be born when he's old? And all of us before it and after it are talking about your first birth and your second birth. Can a man enter in the second time into his mother's womb? You were born of the first time, you were born of water. Amen? Now that excuse to some of you, that's because you've been listening to the wrong kind of preaching. You were born of water the first time in the context. You're born of water the first time. You're born of the Spirit the second time. Jesus proved it when he said, that which is born of flesh is flesh. That's your first verse. That which is born of Spirit is Spirit. That's your second verse. You can't put baptism in there no matter how hard you try. I'm telling you, you can be baptized so many times a tadpole will your social security number and die without God and will lay lost without him forever and ever. You can belong to a church in North Carolina and be baptized every Sunday and still not go to heaven when you die. I'm telling you, this is a spiritual birth. I'm talking about you must be born again of the Spirit. It's something that happens inside you, and you cannot. So I just want to point that out to you. The context is first birth and second birth. That's the context of the Scripture. No baptism mentioned at all. And then the third thing I want to say is, your second birth is a spiritual birth. Amen? Nicodemus couldn't see it. He said, how can these things be? He said, I don't understand this. I can't see it. You know what he was saying? I'm blind. When you hear a man say, I don't see why you want to go to church all the time. I don't see why what you get out of going down there every night. Count meeting coming up here in a couple of weeks. There'll be people drive by here. They'll see all them hundreds of cars, hundreds and hundreds of people coming in here. And they'll say, I don't see what them people get out of that. They're always saying, I don't see, I don't see, I don't see, I don't see. You know who can't see? Blind people. You never can see it because all you see is the carpet and the pews and the platform and the guy standing up here. You've got to see far beyond this. And your eyes are never been opened if all you've ever seen at church is a preacher or the choir. There's something far past what I'm standing and me standing here this morning. You'd be very disappointed if you just come and seen me and heard me. Lord have mercy. What a letdown that would be. But my prayer is this morning that God will let you see him and that you'd see him high and lifted up, dying on the cross for your sins. And if you get one glimpse of him, come and put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and the that split second you become born again by the Spirit of God. You say, I went to all and prayed one time and it didn't do no good. That can happen. A lot of people do that. And I believe this. I believe a lot of people are born again before they ever get to the altar. No doubt about it. The second you are willing to surrender to his, the second you look to Jesus Christ for eternal life, the second that you say, hey, I'm a sinner, the scales fall off. You see him dying for your sins in your place, and you say, I'll take that as my payment. Glory to God, he knows it. Hallelujah. I'm not talking about being a Baptist. I'm not talking about being a Methodist. The great God of glory coming down and living on the inside of sinful man. Lord have mercy, I can't wait till I get to heaven, get my new voice so I can shout about that for a million years. If you've been born again, say amen. Thank God, I know what it means to be born again. You say, Brother Danny, you're a Baptist. I'm glad the Lord made for the Baptist then. I've been another dead Baptist and there's plenty enough of them. Thank God for them born again. Tell you about a man one time lived in this old world. His name was George Whitfield. I'll tell you this, and then we're going to pray and give an invitation. George Whitfield, at 15 years old, when he's 15 years old, worked in a bar selling drinks, selling alcohol. George Whitfield, some of you that go to church, you recognize that name immediately, but maybe you don't know the story behind it. His mother, they made him quit school when he's 15 so he could work in a bar and help him to run a tavern. And his job, all he done while he was serving drinks was mock the local preacher downtown named Brother Cole. And George Whitfield, at 15 years old, would get up and mimic the preacher and make fun of him. And they said he had it down pat. They said he was a great actor, and he could act just like different people. And said he'd get up and make fun of the preacher, and he'd say, "I speak the word Almighty God." And everybody would laugh, and they'd slam the drinks down and say, "Bravo, pour me another drink." And old George lived a wicked, wicked life. And he was very smart, and he could do anything. Very, very, you know, just common brain, had a lot of sense. And somebody said, "George, you ought to go to Yale." This was in England. They said, "You ought to go to Yale, George, get you an education." And he went to Yale, and while he was at Yale, he met two brothers who was really famous during those times. This is in the 1700s. One's name was John Wesley, and the other was Charles Wesley. They were the two famous of the Wesley brothers. 17 or 19 of them kids, I think, that Susanna Wesley raised. And John Wesley was a great preacher, the founder of Methodism, the Methodist Church. And Charles Wesley, his brother. And they had such an impact on George Whitfield that old George Whitfield, he said he started getting under conviction. And he said, "I'm going to start doing better." And they had a club called the Bible Club. And some people call them the Bible Bands. Call them like fanatics. They call them the God Club. They call them, this is in the 1700s. They made fun of them because they all got together and studied the Bible all the time. They said, "Oh, that bunch of fools, man. They're a bunch of idiots sitting there and studying the Bible. Bible bigots. Bible fanatics. God Club." And old George Whitfield said, "I want to join the club." And he joined the club and went by all the rules. He found no peace there on the inside. He was doing everything he's supposed to do, but he still had no peace. He started giving his money away. He's such amazed that people do to try to ease that old guilty conscience, ain't it? He started giving money away. He said, "I'm going to straighten up and go to church. I'm going to do better." But still, down on the inside, there was no difference. It may be that way for you this morning. Maybe you're here up in the balcony, back there in the back, and you're trying your best to do good. But deep down inside, when you lay down at night, there's no peace. There's no satisfaction. There's no joy. You don't have peace with God. That's where George Whitfield was. And boy, I tell you what, somebody gave him a book. Gave him a book about God's workings in the life of man. And he read that book and he said, "God showed me something." And he said, night after night, he rolled around on the floor. He'd pray an earnest prayer and he'd pray and finally got sick. And he got sick, somebody couldn't stand it. And he said, "God, whatever I gotta do, whatever I have to do, you show me so I can get some peace on the inside." And suddenly it dawned on him that Jesus cried out on the cross, "I thirst." And he said, "Well, it worked for him, reckon it worked for me." And he looked up to God and he said, "I thirst." And he said, when he said that, there was a peace flooding his soul. And he said, "God, come in." And God Almighty moved in that man's body. And George Whitfield got born again. Hallelujah. Amen. Lord have mercy. And he's just a young man. And within a year, he was preaching in the largest churches in London. And he came to America. And he had a great revival in the state of Georgia. And revival fires were lit under the preaching of George Whitfield. And you know what he preached on? "You must be born again." Amen. And many people started getting born again right and left. He said, "You can't get it by yourself. You must be born again." When he was 26 years old, God was using him all over this country and England preaching, "You must be born again." He was even a skeptical man by the name of Benjamin Franklin said, "It seems the whole world's getting religion." He said that about George Whitfield. He preached to 15,000 people in the Boston Common. He preached to 30,000 people out in the open fields when the embarrassed church, state church, church in London closed its doors to him. They said, we can't have him. You know what they said? We don't approve of his conduct. We don't approve of his speech. This man is gross. This man is he's abrasive. This man has inflammatory remarks. It's always been that way. The organized church has always shut the doors on the preaching of the real truth and the gospel. And they said, get it out of here, Whitfield. And he went out in the field and preached, and 30,000 people showed up to hear him. And he'd stand up there without a PA system, and he'd echo it down through the valleys. You must be born again. And that old boy did that for 30 more years. And while he was laying there, had one revival and had 10,000 people saved in a single meeting. That's three times more than it was on the day of Pentecost. One revival meeting. George Whitfield. They said after he died, somebody said he's the most extraordinary men of our day. And they said that old boy was laying in there in his bed chamber on his dying deathbed. And he had a candle lit there. 30 years after he had been born again. And he was dying, his body was weak, and the crowd was outside down on the main street saying, preach, George, preach. Preach, George, preach. Preach, George, preach. They said that old man got out of bed and come over out of that window and raised up his finger and preached his last sermon. And he stopped the window of that crowd. And that candle burned about halfway down. And then the church historian said that he went back and laid down on the bed and laid there a little while, said his last few dying words. He said, I'm weary in the work of the Lord, but I'm not weary of the work of the Lord. And he said, I'm not ready to go on home to be with my Lord. Had that touched me so many, many years ago. And oh boy, God's born again, thank God. And buddy, you know what? He laid down there, and they said it was the wildest thing. They said as a crowd was standing there saying, preach, George, preach. He laid down on his bed, grabbed his last few breaths, and they said that candle flickered out as he drawed his last breath. And the life went out of George Whitfield, and his soul went to be with Jesus. And he's one of the greatest men of church history. He was born again. And the same thing can happen to you this morning in this church on this day. I preach the same message that George Whitfield preached. You must be born again. You can't make it by yourself. You'll never be good enough. You need help from God. He's here to give it to you. Let's stand by our heads for prayer. Heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. No one's moving around. Please be patient with us in prayer just for a few minutes. Now there's somebody here this morning, way up in the balcony, maybe down here on the floor in the front, or the back. You must be born again, friend. You must be born again. You cannot be good enough by yourself. No matter how hard you try, you'll never satisfy God living in religion. You must be born again. People are praying, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Very quietly, you listen. We're going to give the invitation. I want you people in here this morning to say, preacher, you're right. I know that I need to be born again. And I know I can never make it to heaven unless I've been born again. And preacher, I want you in this church to pray for me this morning. I don't want to die and go to hell without God. I want to be saved. I want to go to heaven. And I want to ask this church this morning to pray for me. We'd like to pray for you this morning. Is there anyone? Just slip up your hand. Take it right back down. Let us pray for you this morning. Anywhere? Slip your hand up. God bless you, sir. God bless you, ma'am. Is there another one? God bless you. I see your hands back over here. I see hands. Thank you. You can put them down. Is there another one up there in the balcony? Anywhere? Just slip it up. We're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to point you out. But we sure would like to. You can be born again, friend. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Say, preacher, remember me in this prayer. Please pray for me. I want to go to heaven when I die. I need to be born again. Please. Anybody? Raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Take it right back down. God bless you. There's about four or five here this morning that's raised their hand, and maybe others is too scared. Let me tell you something. Come to Jesus Christ this morning. The greatest miracle in history can happen to you. It's called being born again. It's a brand new fresh start with a clean slate. Just like your little bitty baby, you must be born again. If this has never happened to you, we're going to pray, and on the very first verse of this song, I want you that lifted your hand, just get out of your seat, get walk right out of that pew and down here at this altar, and let's settle this thing before you leave here this morning. You say, I'm afraid I can't live like a Christian. You're absolutely right. You're right about that. But the Lord will help you. The Lord will help you if you'll let Him. Father, I pray in Jesus' name, the Holy Spirit of God will come and do a great and mighty work here this morning. I've tried my best to obey You. I pray You'd take it. May it find a lodging place in the hearts of sinners. Bring conviction and draw sinners to Jesus Christ. In Your blessed name, pray. And for Jesus' sake, amen.